And that takes us to the next concept called MIMO, multiple input, multiple output. So if the transmitter has multiple outputs and the receivers has multiple input, so each of these receivers will receive many signals from many different outputs and many different reflections of those outputs. And then you can do some DSP around here and somehow get lot more signal. In fact, if you did the things right, then if this guy has 2 and you have 3, you should be able to get 6 times more signal than if you had just 1 antenna each. Here's the thing, if the transmitter had 1 antenna and the receiver had 1 antenna, they can get some signal with all these reflections and everything else. Now they say, no, look, transmitter, you buy 1 more. So transmitter has 2 antennas, so now at least you should be able to do twice as much work. Right? Now the receiver says, I am going to get 1 more, so they have 2 more, so 4. So they should get 4 times. But in practice, you don't get that. You generally get somewhere in between the minimum and the maximum. So the minimum is the minimum of these 2, which is 2 by 3, the minimum is 2, and the maximum could be 6. Okay, but so here is the thing. For bimax, 802.16e, for bimax at 2.5 gigahertz, using 10 megahertz TDD, and all these symbols will, if they don't make sense, it doesn't matter really right now, because when you present any numbers, it's good to tell what the numbers apply to. So we are just telling down to upload ratio of 2 to 1. But basically, you will understand this when we come to bimax. The transmitter to receiver, if it is 1 by 1, the signal, you could get 1.2 bits per hertz. With 1 by 2, you could get 1.8. With 2 by 2, you could get 2.8, 2 by 4, 4.4, and 4 by 2, 3.7, 4 by 4, 5.1. These are measured numbers in some lab or in some environment. They could be different in some other environment. But this is just a simple example saying that with 4 by 4, you don't get 16 times, you only get 5 times. Actually, if you divide by 1.2, you only get 4 times. So with 1.1, you can get 1.2 bits per hertz. With 4 by 4, with 4 by 2, you get 3.7. So this is a complex system. But MIMO helps. It may not be straight, linear, common linear factor of whatever you put in, but you get better than 1. And that's why everything is MIMO today. Okay? Even your phone is MIMO. Everything is MIMO. Now, we move to multiple access method. Now, we already talked about multiple access method, but I just want to tell you how the things have progressed in time, history. Basically, we talked about multiple access method, time division, multiple access, TDMA. By the way, always be clear what you mean, multiplexing or multiple access. TDM, time division, multiplexing. TDMA is time division multiple access. Lot of people confuse. I have seen red papers and reviewed papers where people don't know the difference and they just use one for the other. Okay? So multiple access is when multiple people are trying to share the medium by design. And so TDMA, so basically 1G, the first generation of cell phones had FDMA, frequency division multiple access. What that meant was the cell phone number 1 will use this frequency, cell phone number 2 will use a different frequency, third frequency, fourth frequency, and so on and so forth. Every phone was assigned a frequency. Basically, the first thing you did was you said, told the tower, look, I want to talk, and they will say, okay, now talk on this frequency. Okay, so that was FDMA. 2G was TDMA. Okay, GSM is TDMA, GSM, right? So basically, when you talk, they tell you what time you want to you should talk. So they had slots. You're on slot number 5, you're on 6, you're on 7. So you selected your slot and you talked in that slot. Nobody else talked in that slot. 3G is CDMA. So you talked at all the time on all the frequency, but you had a different code. Everybody used a different code, but you used all the time and all the frequencies. And 4G, are actually 3 plus G, because 3.5, 3.9, 4, 5, everything else in the future and today right now, as far as you know, is using OFDMA. OFDMA is orthogonal frequency division multiple axis. And I'm going to explain what that is. So OFDMA, in OFDMA, everybody has both combination of everything that we have talked about. Is that you have a time, you have a frequency, and other things as well. Okay, so but you are given a slot and a frequency. Okay, but there's more. So let me talk about OFDM first before we go to OFDMA. OFDM is orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. And it will become clear as to what is multiple axis and multiplexing on this slide. So basically, if you are given a very thick pipe to send something, you have two choices. To send one signal which takes the whole pipe, or send many, many signals, each taking little bit of the pipe. It turns out the second method is much better. Okay? What it means is that if you have a 1 megahertz channel, it is better to send 100 kilohertz, to divide it into 100 kilohertz channels like this, rather than have one big one. And so it is better to use tiny channels than to use thick channels. So basically, total number of bits that you will get by tiny channels is much higher than with the thick channels, and it will become clearer as we go more and more into some more theory. So basically, people decided that this is better, and therefore they started dividing the band. So frequency band could be divided into 256 or more subbands. Actually 256. You could do it with 4 bands to it. It's not that. So 4 bands are better than 1, 16 are better than 4, 256 is better than 16, and on, you know, 512, 1024, as many bands as you want to put. So it is good to have very, 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 very small channels. And they have to be done orthogonally. Orthogonal means the peak of one is in the low point of the other. So this is one band and this is other band. You notice that the peak here for the black is at the bottom of the red. And the peak of the red is at the bottom of the black and the blue. And the peak of the blue is at the bottom of, you know, their neighbors. Right? And this is basically the power of that channel. So the highest power happens at that frequency and then the lower power goes around it. And so this is how you divide it. Now each of these is a band, right? It is a small band. On each of these bands you can send a signal with BPSK, QPSK and, you know, QAM and, you know, 256 QAM. Whatever you can do it on each band. And in fact, you can do a different QAM on each band. So on the red, you could do 256. On the black, you could do 4. On the blue, you could do 124 and so on. And so this is what, once they discovered it, this has become a norm everywhere, even on the wire they use it. So when you get a DSL at your home, previously the DSL was running at very low speed. Now they're offering higher and higher, you know, sometimes they give you 3 megabits per second, then they give you 16 megabits, then 20 megabits, then 30 megabits. So there are several things they're playing with. One, they're playing with QAMs, but they're also playing with OFDMA. On the wire, they send many, many tiny channels. And the reason it is possible now, and it was not possible in the past, is because now we have FFT and IFFT. FFT is the fast Fourier transform and inverse fast Fourier transform. Right? Now we can do that very fast. Fast Fourier transform is fast, right? So there are chips that come, and DSP chips, we call them, digital signal processing chips. We can buy DSP chips, we can do, you know, in microseconds and nanoseconds all this calculation, and we can handle 1024 channels at the same time. You know, 1024 is small for today. We are just going up and up in the numbers. Previously, we were not able to do 256 QAM. Then we talked about, you know, we can do 1024, 2000, 4000, 8000. Similarly here, we were not able to do too many channels, 256, then 1024, and on and on. So the numbers keep going up and up. Okay. So this is called OFDM. So this is orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. And multiplexing means that many people going in the same direction. Okay, like duplexing. So this is going in this one, this is going in this direction. In this case, multiplexing, they are going in the same direction at the same time. Right? Where multiple access means that, you know, somehow we share it. So this is more of a how you come in and how you get out. And this one is, you know, how you move. So advantages of OFDM. OFDM is very easy to implement. The computational complexity, for those of you who understand this term, it is order of B log BT. B is the bandwidth and T is the delay spread. B is the bandwidth and T is the delay spread. If you have a channel which has a delay of T, a spread of T, and has a bandwidth of B, then this is compared to OB square T for equalization. So previously if you had a big channel, the problem with the big channel is that the power is everywhere different. So here in, if you had this much frequency from, if you had plot from frequency from here to there, the power would be very different, and then you have to do equalizer so that they all look same. So it is much better than that. Graceful degradation is access delay, if you, so the things don't just kill each other. Robustness against frequency selective burst errors. So suddenly you get a noise in the middle of some place, it just doesn't kill you. Allows adaptive modulation and coding of subcarrier. So each subcarrier can be modulated differently. Adaptive means if there's more noise, you can put a lower QAM on this. If there's less noise, you can put higher QAM on this. Robust against narrow band interference. So if there is something that only affects a small part, this is narrow band interference. This is robust against that. Allows pilot subcarrier for channel estimation. And you don't have to use all the subcarriers. You can use some of them just for pilot, which means to measure the system. So every 4th, 5th, every 8th, every 16th band is used for measurement. It's called a pilot. Yeah, question. Complexity?
Yeah, computational complexity, the O stands for...
Order of. Okay, so I don't know where they teach this complexity stuff, but there is some course in computer science. So whenever you have an algorithm, okay, it has to be, we have to measure the complexity of the algorithm. And the complexity could be order n, where n is the number of people, n is something, whatever parameter n is. It could be n squared. So as the number n goes up, the complexity goes up. The computation time required for that, CPU time required for that is power of order of n squared, n cube. And it could be exponential in n, in which case we say np complete. Right? So this is basically all saying is that if you double B, the work becomes double. It is order of B. And log BT. So, you know, I mean, if you double T, it doesn't affect too much. Right? So you calculate what is inside, and that will tell you how much your work will go up if you change B or T. Right? So this is almost like a linear, you know, so we would say this is a linear complexity because log is, you know, almost like one, right? So it's linear complexity.